it's with great honor that we have Pastor Chad Veach with us. Stand up and show some love and some honor to Pastor Chad tonight.
Come on, why don't we give a shout of praise to Jesus tonight? Come on, let's lift up our voice. Come on, everybody back up on your feet. Everybody back up on your feet. Everybody back up on your feet. How y'all feeling tonight? It's good to be in Texas. Don't mess with Texas. How many of y'all are from Texas? I got mad love for Texas barbecue. And I think that the Mexican food in Texas is really good. By the way, are there any Mexicans in the house? I'm a half Mexican. My mom's from Mexicali. Any family from Mexicali? Okay. Órale pues. ¿Qué estás haciendo? ¿Qué onda? Taco Bell. Hey, we're going to give Jesus a big shout of praise, and I want to do one more thing. I have learned in today's society that one of the greatest things that we could do is we can tell the story of what God is doing. And anybody thankful that through social media we can tell the world what God is doing in this place and what God is doing in our hearts? I got to be honest with you. It's my first time here. And when I was in the back and I saw the live stream and when I walked in this place and said, man, the world does not know the greatness of what we're experiencing in this piece. And so y'all mind if we get on my Snapchat and y'all go crazy and tell my snap and everybody what God is doing in Dallas, Texas? Anybody think that God is up to something big in Dallas, Texas? All right, Josh, come here. All right, y'all make some noise for my boy Josh. This is Josh right here. By the way, I want to give a shout out to Josh. If you are a single leader and over the age of 30, spirit break out. Okay? So this is what we're going to do. Just a second, Josh is going to press record, and then I'm going to talk to the camera for a minute, and then I'm going to let him come. He's going to start on this side and go this side, and we're going to lose our mind. But hold up. It's not, I don't want you to lose your mind like, oh, I'm on the Snapchat. I want you to lose your mind like something is going down in this place. Touch somebody next to you and go, I need you to get crazy. Okay, back up a little bit, Josh. Back up a little bit. I need you to get, y'all ready? We're going to show people what God is doing. Josh, go the whole time. Go the whole time through it, okay? Okay, tell me when you hit record. What's going on, Snap? We're here in Dallas, Texas. Something is going down in this place. Woo! Wish you were here. Come on, make some noise for Jesus tonight. Amen and amen. I'm posting it right now. Find a place to sit down. Go to Acts chapter 2, verse 1. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. How many of y'all love Pastor Mark Francie? Anybody love Pastor Dustin Bates? Anybody love Pastor Chris in the front row back from the hospital? Make some noise if you honor this man right here. We love you, man. Unbelievable. That's right. PC. If you love them, you'll get a tattoo that says PC. I'm playing. He stood up. I'll do it. Let's see you do it then, Judas. I'm kidding. Like, why did I call him Judas? That's actually funny. Go to Acts chapter 2, verse 1. Have you had a good day? Did you have any coffee today? You did? Raise your hand if you had coffee today. Let me see your hand. I love you guys. I don't think God does anything in your life till you start drinking coffee. So dumb. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. Actually, before we read some scriptures, can I just tell you what we're about to read? Is that all right? I want to give you a little bit of context to where we're jumping in tonight and where we're going. By the way, let's put our hands together for the worship team who was so fantastic tonight. Unbelievable. Now, what we are about to read in this text, Acts chapter 2, verse 1, where we're about to go is we believe that Jesus Christ came to this earth, lived a life for 33 years, made the decision to go and die for the sins of the world. Does anybody agree with me that you would believe that Jesus died on a cross for the sins of the world? Does anybody believe that tonight? Our belief is that we believe that Jesus came in the city of Jerusalem. He was betrayed. He laid down his life after he was brutally beaten. He went to a cross. He died for our past, present, and future sins. And we believe that Jesus, when he died, he didn't stay dead for very long. Because we believe that though he went to the grave, our theology says that death could not defeat him. And the grave could not hold him down because our God is not dead. Tonight we're worshiping a God that is alive. Does anybody agree with what I'm preaching? Come on, give God some praise tonight if you believe that Jesus is alive. So Jesus died for the sins of the world, goes down for 3 days, gets up out the grave. Now the Bible says implicitly that when he gets up out the grave, he spends 40 days with his guys, his holy helpers, his click, click, click. Hey. Hey. Okay. Sorry. I do drugs. They're Christian drugs. He spends 40 days with the disciples, explaining to them what this reality now means, what it means to be now in Christ, and what his death and resurrection now brings them as believers for 40 days before he goes back to heaven, where there is incredibly fast Wi-Fi, amazing air conditioning, and all the FIFA soccer a man could want. Before he goes back to heaven, he demands, he does not suggest, he says, guys, I need you to stay in Jerusalem. Everybody say Jerusalem. I need you to stay here in Jerusalem until the promise of the Holy Spirit comes. Now, you have to understand, Jesus has been hyping this thing up for quite some time. John chapter 14, John chapter 16, Jesus is saying such outlandish, incredible, over-the-top, audacious things about this guy, the Holy Spirit. He says things like this. He says, guys, when the Holy Spirit comes, it's going to be to your advantage. When he comes, he'll help you. When the Holy Spirit comes, he's going to teach you. He's going to lead you. He's going to remind you of everything I've ever spoken. He's going to be your comforter. He's saying, it's someone better than me is coming. I'm just going to be honest with you right now. If I was one of the disciples and Jesus told me someone better than me is coming, I would have looked at Jesus and been like, yeah, right, Jesus. Something better than you is coming. Yeah, right, Jesus. Is the next guy going to walk on water? Is the next guy going to turn water into wine like you did? Because remember that one time we was at the party and you took the smart water bottle and said, boom, Cabernet. is the next guy, because if he don't, he's not better than you, Jesus. Jesus has been hyping the Holy Spirit for so long. He says, for 40 days, these guys, do not leave this city, a city of chaos, a city of conflict, a city that's not safe for these guys. He says, do not leave Jerusalem to go out and do what I've called you to do until the power and the promise of the Holy Spirit comes. Now, let's pick up the text so you understand where we are. We are in Jerusalem. Jesus is now back in heaven. He is playing FIFA soccer on unlimited Wi-Fi. He's enjoying the right hand of the Father. And watch what the Bible says in Acts chapter 2, verse 1. It says, when the feast of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Without warning, there was a sound like a strong wind, gale force. No one could tell where it came from. It filled the whole building. Then, like a wildfire, the Holy Spirit spread throughout their ranks, and they started speaking in a number of different languages as the Spirit prompted them. There were many Jews staying in Jerusalem just then, devout pilgrims from all over the world. When they heard the sound, they came on the run. Then when they heard one after another, their own mother tongues being spoken, they were thunderstruck. They couldn't for the life of them figure out what was going on. And they kept saying, hold up, wait a minute, stop this, because I ain't with it. Check it out. He said, hold up, aren't these men Galileans? How come we're hearing them talk in our various mother tongues? Parthians and Medes and Elamites, visitors of Mesopotamia and Judea and Cappadocia. I'm just going to tell you right now, when you read the Bible and you come to words that you don't know how to enunciate, just fake it till you make it. Like I'm saying, like I know how to say it. I have no idea. You know what I'm saying? Parthians and Medes and Elamites, visitors from Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia and Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, immigrants from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, even Cretans and Arabs. They're speaking our languages, describing God's mighty works. Their heads were spinning. They couldn't make head or tail of any of it. They talked back and forth confused. What in the world is going on here? Others joked around, yo, don't even worry about it. They're drunk on cheap wine. It's amazing to me. When the church started and people walked into a meeting like we're in tonight, the world could not figure out what was going on. They said, truly, these guys, they got to be drunk on something to act so crazy for their religion. They got to be on something to get that lit for Jesus. They got to be abnormal. Something's not right here. Come on, how many of you know when you get the Spirit of God moving in your life, you got to act a fool in the presence of the Lord because you know how great He is. Oh, don't get all cute now. Come on, anybody come today with the power of God running through your veins. I want to preach a message tonight. If you're taking notes, you can write down the title. It's called, I Got an Agent. I got an agent. Why don't you look at somebody next to you and tell them real fast, just say, I got an agent. Tell somebody. Look at your second option, who is also a good human, and say, I got an agent. I got an agent. Everybody say it together. Say, I got an agent. Say it a little louder. I got an agent. Tap the person in front of you. Tell them. Say, I got an agent. I got an agent. Look at somebody behind you. Twist your neck a little bit. Twist your neck. Say, hey, I don't know if you know this. I got an agent. I went out. I got an agent. I got an agent. I got an agent. I'm gonna pray over the message tonight. If you would be so kind, would you bow your heads, close your eyes, and let's believe that God will speak to us tonight. God, thank you so much. What wonderful moments that we're spending with you this week, and truly you are in this place. We ask that as we gather around your word, that we would be strengthened and encouraged by it. Thank you, Lord, that you love us. Thank you that you're for us. We ask that on a night like tonight, open up our eyes so we can see Jesus. Open up our ears so we can hear the Holy Spirit. Do what only you can do in these moments and in this setting.
We are so grateful that you are who you say you are, and you can do what you said you could do. We declare that to our soul and our situation. We love you more than life itself. And God, we are praying that this next year in the city of Dallas, that the Dallas Cowboys will win the Super Bowl. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. And we all said together, come on, Cowboy fans, where you at? We're praying for you. We're praying for you. We're praying for you. We're in Dallas. We ought to pray for Dallas. Anyone tonight, you just lift up your hand if this is you. Anyone admittedly so, this is me, by the way, admittedly so, if you're honest, you would say, for sure, this is me. Anyone here tonight, you are a hype person. You hype stuff up. Let me just say your hand. I'm a hype person. I love it. If you're a hype person, make some noise. I love hype people. My favorite. I love them. Best people. Best. I love them. Hype people are my favorite people. Hype people are the best because hype people, okay, all right. Hype people are always hyping stuff up. You know what I'm talking about? Like, if a hype person goes to a new coffee place, they're like, oh my gosh, I just went to the best coffee shop ever. Like, hype people because they hype stuff up. They meet a new friend. They're like, have you guys met Rick? Rick is so funny. Rick is he's my new friend, and Rick's the greatest ever. Hype people are interesting, though, because everything they say, you have to divide in half. You know what I'm saying? So if a hype person says, we had the best time, there was 500 people there, you know right away, okay, it was an okay time, there was 200 people there. You know what I'm saying? When you meet Rick, you know Rick's okay, but he's funny on text, he's not that funny in person, okay? Because you learn from experience from a hype person that they hype stuff up. I'm a hype person, and so is my wife. So in my home, in my house, my wife and I, we just walk around the house hyping each other up. Yo, what's up? Ah, we just hype. Just, that's all we do is hype, okay? So recently, my wife came to my home. She came back to the house. She said, babe, I just found the greatest, the best. It's gonna be your favorite. I found the new Mediterranean place. Now, my wife knows that my favorite food in the whole world is Mediterranean food. I love Mediterranean food. You give me a little bit of pita and some hummus bread, revival, okay? So that's how I get down. So my wife came back and said, babe, you're going to love this place. So I said, well, go and get some. I do not like to eat Mediterranean food at the restaurant because when I get all up in the hummus, I make a mess. So I eat in my house, in my casa. So my wife, she goes to the Mediterranean place. She gets a whole bunch of Mediterranean food from this new spot. She brings it back to the house. She lays it before me. When I'm sitting there, I'm halfway through my meal. I'm about 50% through the meal. I put my fork down. I look at my wife. I look at my wife. I said, woman, you didn't tell me the half of how good this place is. Oh my gosh, go and get some more. I need more lamb. I need more chicken. I need more of this yellow rice. I was so excited because she hyped something up and it delivered. I want to tell you tonight that Jesus had been hyping and hyping the Holy Spirit, but when it came in all of its glory, he didn't even tell us the half of how good this thing was going to be. Come on, give him some praise tonight. If you believe the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God and all that we need to lead us in the right place. Oh, he didn't tell us the half of how good this thing was going to be. By the way, the reason why Jesus was so excited about the Holy Spirit was because Jesus knew how limited he was. Jesus knew he was one man that could be in one place. He was not able to be omnipresent. But Jesus was excited because he knew that his death and his resurrection was going to unleash on the earth the Spirit of Jesus. Please hear me. The Holy Spirit is not an alternative spirit. The Holy Spirit is Jesus.
It's the spirit of Jesus. It's Jesus that dwells within you, that talks to you and leads you and guides you. Jesus was so ecstatic because he knew he was going to be all up in you, talking to you, leading you, helping you, convicting you. Come on, anybody thankful today that the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead, come on, that's the spirit. Y'all got to give him some praise tonight because the Holy Spirit is inside of us. I love this about Jesus being so excited. He's going like, guys, do you understand? When this thing comes on the earth, whoo! He's gonna help you. He's gonna lead you. He's just ecstatic. I want to give you some thoughts tonight. I'm gonna give you four things to write down. But write down number one tonight, why Jesus was so excited. He was so excited about the Holy Spirit because number one, the Holy Spirit is the ultimate helper. He's an active agent. He is the ultimate helper. He's an active agent. He works, you know. He works the day shift and the night shift. You ever meet somebody and they're a workaholic, or you have a parent? Don't raise your hand to tell on your mommy or daddy that's a workaholic. But you ever know somebody that works too much? They work all the time. I have a friend in Los Angeles. He works too much. He works the day shift, gets a couple hours off, goes back and works the night shift. We can never go on trips. We can never have fun. All that this man does is work. Can I tell you tonight, all the Holy Spirit does in your world is he goes to work. He works the day shift. He works the night shift. He works the midnight shift. He is always at work in your life. And what is he doing when he's at work? Watch what he's doing. He's guiding you. He's comforting you. He's leading you. He's reminding you of what God spoke over your life. He's taking you to Jesus. He's convicting you of sin. By the way, condemnation is from the devil and it drives you away from God, but conviction is from the Holy Spirit and it takes you right to God. Anybody thankful today that the Holy Spirit convicts you when you think wrong and you say wrong and you act wrong? Come on, anybody thankful that you got the Holy Spirit saying, no, 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 you're better than that. You're greater than that. The Holy Spirit is the ultimate helper. He's an active agent. I live in Los Angeles. We live in Hollywood. And in Hollywood, we in our church is in West Hollywood. And we got all this young Hollywood in our church. All these, you know, upstart wannabe actors and models and, you know, guys that are trying to be big in music. And they're waiting tables or they're working some job, but they're trying to make it big in L.A. at the same time. And I'll often ask these people in our church, I'll say, hey, how's it going? How's modeling or how's, you know, acting going? Are you laying a good gig? And they will often say, the young Hollywood in our church will often give me the same reply. They'll say, you know what I had to do? Just the other day, I had to fire my agent. I said, you fired your agent? Don't you need your agent? Yeah, fired my agent. Well, why would you fire your agent? Well, you know, because my agent wasn't working hard for me. My agent, you know, started working for so-and-so, but wasn't getting me the right gigs, wasn't opening up doors for me, wasn't really, you know, in my corner the way that, so I had to fire my agent. Let me encourage you tonight. You got an agent that works on your life. You got an agent that's working the night shift. You got an agent that's working double time. Come on, anybody thankful tonight that you got the ultimate helper? He's an active agent. He's at work in your life. And by the way, the Holy Spirit doesn't start working on you when you're doing good. He works on you even when you're doing bad. The Holy Spirit doesn't go like, oh, you want to walk away from church? Well, we're going to walk away from you. No, even when you're in your darkest place, when you're in your worst moments, the Holy Spirit is at that party. He's on that couch. He's in that bedroom. He's talking to you saying, no, 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 I'm at work in your life. I'm an active agent. Do you know who you're called to be? Do you know what we've said for you? Do you know we got plans? Come on, y'all got to give him some praise tonight. If you believe the Holy Spirit, he's the ultimate helper. Y'all come on, get a little bit louder than that. We're having church tonight. He's the ultimate helper. He's an active agent. And by the way, I love this about the Holy Spirit. You can write down number two. When he shows up to work, when he shows up to help, he speaks, write down number two. The Holy Spirit speaks your language. Did you notice what happened? These dudes, Jesus says, yo, I gotta go. I'm going back to heaven. I'm gonna sit at the right hand of the Father. I'm gonna be praying for you. I'm going to be praying for y'all. Anybody encouraged tonight that Jesus tonight is praying for us? I know it's great to have your grandmama or your mama pray, but I'm glad that Jesus is praying for me. If you're a Cowboy fan, you better thank God he's praying for you. Somebody, come on. Jesus said, okay, yeah, we hear you, Romo. And that made me laugh. Like it was a girl's voice. I called her Romo. How dumb is that? And so Jesus goes back. He goes back to heaven, and he tells the guys, wait here. Now, the Bible says that they go check in the Holiday Inn. I think they're on the eighth floor. They're scared for their life. They're in some hotel room with two acoustic guitars singing Oceans from the top of their lung. They're like so afraid, like, and I will call upon your name. Like, they are in the eighth floor of the hotel, Holiday Inn, and all of a sudden, like a mighty rushing wind, the Holy Spirit shows up. Now, the Bible says when the Holy Spirit showed up like a mighty rushing wind, they started to speak in tongues, and all these guys from Mesopotamia and Persia and all these cities that I've enunciated poorly, they all rushed. And did you hear what they all said when they showed up at church? They all said, hold up. We hear God being described in our language. You want to know why? Because when the Holy Spirit shows up, he speaks your language. Anybody thankful tonight that God is not hard to understand? Because when he shows up, he gives you a phrase, he gives you a feeling, he gives you an unction, he gives you a dream, he gives you a vision, he gives you a thought. Come on, I'm thankful tonight that when God shows up, he knows how to speak my language. I remember when I was in high school, I played high school basketball, and in my sophomore year, I played half junior varsity, I played two quarters for the junior varsity team, halftime where I go up, and the other two quarters, I was eligible to play varsity. This one year, this particular year, my sophomore year, I was teamed up with another teammate of mine. His name was Ashley. Ashley was from Georgia. He was from Georgia, so he had that southern accent. He talked like this, and his name was Ashley, but because of his accent, he called himself Atley. And so his name was Atley, and he was from Georgia, and we spent the whole year together doing two quarters junior varsity, two quarters varsity, every practice, every game, every bus trip, everything that we did. It was me and Atley that were partnered together. You ever be with someone socially, and they're talking, and you can't understand what they're saying? This ever happened to you? Yeah. And you get in that situation like they're talking and you're like. You have no idea what they're saying.
Sure, I know.
Like he would be talking on the bus about God knows what. And I'm like, oh. And you get mad at me sometimes, like, yo, I just said that my dog died. Oh. Because I had no idea what this guy was. Some of us get discouraged because we think like, oh, I don't know how to hear from God. I don't know what God's saying to me. No, I'm telling you today, the Bible says my sheep will recognize my voice, because when the Holy Spirit starts speaking, he speaks your language. He knows how to get a hold of you. He knows what you need. He knows what you need, when you need, and how you need it. Somebody give God some praise tonight if you believe that Holy Spirit knows how to speak your language. He knows how to talk to you. He knows what you need. He knows just the phrase and just the thought and just the unction and the picture. He knows how to talk to you. He speaks so it's so clear. It's so some of you already this week, God got a hold of you on the first night, and God said some word over you. I love you. God said something over you. I got a plan for you. God said, it's amazing to me. We can be in a service, and Mark Francis preaching, and everybody leaves, and people, they all say the same thing. Somebody will walk out and say, I felt like God was speaking to me. How could it be that one man with a microphone's talking, but God is going to every single person and giving a word in season? Why? Because it could be one orator, but the Holy Spirit, he is the great witness that comes to every person and talks to him. Anybody thankful tonight that God talks to you and speaks your language? Y'all give him some praise tonight if you believe that he speaks your language. People leave in church like, I don't know why, but man, tonight was for me. And the person next to him going like, I don't know why, but tonight was for me. Like, what character was that? That was so weird. What a weird accent, right? Like, where does that guy live? Anyways, every one of us, we leave church and we say, I feel like God was speaking to me. Why? Because God was talking to you. Because the Holy Spirit is an active agent. He's the ultimate helper. He speaks your language. And watch what he does. I love this about the Holy Spirit. He shows up to work in our life, work the night shift, the day shift, the midnight shift. He's working, he's helping, he's guiding, he's shaping, he's changing. He's at work in our life. Even when you're doing bad, he's working. He's speaking your language, he's helping you, he's showing up. And watch what he does. I love this about the Holy Spirit. Notice the difference between what he says versus what the adversary says. The adversary wants to talk to you, but all he points out is what you're not. But what the Holy Spirit wants to do is put his arm around you and tell you how much you are loved by Jesus. That's the difference right there. Write that down, number three. The adversary wants to tell you what you're not, but the Holy Spirit wants to come alongside you and tell you how much you are loved by Jesus. The adversary, this is his role. This is who he is. He's a liar, isn't he? The Bible says in Revelation that he stands in front of the throne of grace. He's the accuser of the brethren. All that the devil wants to do, the enemy, the adversary of your soul, all he does is point out to you what you're not. You are not holy. You are not chosen. You are not great. You will never amount to anything. You never fulfill your commitment. Don't you act all churchy right now, because you know what you're addicted to. You know what you're crawling back to. You know you never leave him. You know you're never going to break free from that addiction. All that the devil wants to do is tell you what you're not. You're nothing. You're a nobody. You're not from any special family. You're never going to be great. You're small. You're an idiot. You are so. All he wants to do is shame you. Put shame on your face and shame in your brain and shame all over you. He tells you what you're not. He says you're not. And he stands with his bony little finger and says, God, how dare you try and bless this one? Do you know where they've been? Do you know what they've touched? All he wants to do is say, oh, no, 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 no. She's been bad lately. He's been awful. Have you seen the attitude? Have you seen the rebellion? This is a cusser right here. This is a smoker right here. All the devil wants to do is point out what you're not. But the Holy Spirit, he comes alongside, puts his arm around your shoulder, and says, do you know how much Jesus loves you? Come on, somebody give him some praise tonight. If you believe that Jesus, I don't care what the devil said. I don't care what he pointed out. It cannot remove the love of Jesus. The Holy Spirit puts his arm around you. By the word, the Greek word for the Holy Spirit is the word paraclete. By definition, that's the word encourager in our language. The Holy Spirit is an encourager. He comes and encourages you and says, whoo! Do you know how much heaven's got your back? Do you know how proud of you we are? Holy Spirit puts his arm around you and says, you do realize you're doing better than you think you are. You do know that you're further down the road than you think you are. Do you know what big plans we got for you? Do you know how we've been strategizing and scheming up ways to promote your life? Do you know that we've gone before you? We've got such plans for you. You've got a hope in this house. You got a future in this kingdom. You are called. You are anointed. You are more than a conqueror. You're a chosen generation. You're a royal priesthood. You got kingdom in your veins. Oh, I wish somebody would praise God like you got somebody's arm around your shoulder. I wish somebody would praise the Lord like you got an encourager in your soul. I wish you'd praise the Lord like you got an active agent, an ultimate helper, a Holy Spirit that speaks your. Give him some praise tonight if you believe that he's telling you how much you are loved. Come on, give him some praise tonight in this place if you believe that you are loved. But I don't care what you've been telling. I don't care. Shut your mouth. I'm loved by God. Some of you need to silence your critic. Saying, shut your mouth. There's a greater authority that tells me who I am. I am not defined by failure because I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He paid all my debt. He washed me as white as snow. I am called. I am anointed. I am the head and not the tail. I know who my Father is. I know who my Jesus is. I've got an agent. I wish you'd praise him like you got an agent. You got an agent working things out. You got an agent telling you, shut up, devil. I got an agent. I have a two-year-old. His name is Winston. His name is Winston Charles. He's just the greatest. My two-year-old Winston, please pray, though, he's not saved. He needs salvation mad bad. Like, needs to get saved tonight. My two-year-old Winston, he's the greatest. You know, my son is getting so funny, he's talking. And so my son, you know, we'll go out to the backyard and play sports. He's really into sports, so we'll go. He can last each sport for 1 minute. That's his attention span. And so we'll play basketball, and then we'll play football, and then we'll play baseball, and then we'll play golf. You know, we'll play all the sports. And when we're playing sports, I look at my son, and I say, oh, my gosh, you are such a great athlete. Oh, my gosh, you are unbelievable. Then my son, he's really into clothes. You know, my wife dresses him really cool, so he's into clothes. He'll go upstairs and get his clothes on for church. He'll come downstairs and look at my son and say, oh, my son, you are so handsome. Oh, my gosh. You are such a good-looking kid. My son, we'll go up to, you know, at night, we read books together. When we read books, you know, he can call things out. When I ask him what everything is, and I look at my son when we're going through all the books. I said, son, oh, my gosh, you are so intelligent. You are so smart. You are so bright. I'll ask my son right now. I say, son, who's your best friend? My son, look at me, 2 years old, look at me, go, dad, I'm best friend. Say it again. Say, dad, I'm best friend. I'm telling you right now as a father, I wish to God, I wish I could hire some spirit to go wherever my son went, wherever he goes, that some spirit would be in his ear telling him, you realize that your dad thinks you are so smart? Do you realize that your dad thinks you're the best looking kid in the world? Do you realize that your dad thinks you're such an athlete? You know that your dad says that you're best friends? I'm telling you, Jesus was excited because he knew that the Spirit of God was going to be on your world and in your life, saying, do you know how much your Father loves you? Do you know how much we got a plan for you? Do you realize you're the brightest? You're the greatest? You're the best looking? Come on, give him some praise tonight. If you believe that the active agent is helping you and speaking your language and telling you, you are loved by God. Some of you, your whole life has been dealt a shame hand where you're afraid and ashamed of your parents and ashamed of your finances and ashamed of your neighborhood. And the Bible says, thou, O Lord, art the lifter of my head. Why? Because when he lifts my head, I can walk high and say, devil, shut your mouth. I'm walking high. I know who I am. I'm called. I'm great. I'm anointed. I got a plan. I'm going somewhere. The steps of the righteous are ordered by the Lord. I'm lethal. I'm a bad mamma jamma. I got the Spirit of God on the inside. Now watch this very carefully. Please, just. This is very exciting. All of this is for you. All of this side is for you to get guided and led and comforted and helped and convicted and comforted. All of this is you, for you to hear God and know God and be encouraged in your soul. And all of this is the role of the Holy Spirit. But when the power came in that Holiday Inn room in the eighth floor with two acoustic guitars, Jesus was excited because he realized it wasn't just that these guys were getting an agent to do something in them, but he knew that the power, it was going to do something through them. He knew that all of a sudden the whole thing was going to change, that these guys were going to walk the earth with a little bit of dominion, and they're going to walk the earth with a little bit of power. He looks at the guys and he says, guys, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and then you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, come on, and nations, and the uttermost parts of the world. He knew that this moment would change history because it wasn't that the Holy Spirit was just going to do something in them. The Holy Spirit was about to do something through them. Now, this right here, this is for you. But the power, that's for people. Write down the last point, and I'm going to invite the worship team to come. Number four, the purpose for the power is people. We do not serve a God. We are not in a kingdom that is all about you. The Holy Spirit is not in your life so you can feel warm fuzzies. Oh my gosh, God is so good. I love him. Oh my gosh, this is amazing. This is so sweet. No, I felt really good. It's amazing. I love this stuff. No, like, I got goosebumps. I felt them. I heard a voice, and it told me how much he loved me. This side is for you to understand how much Jesus is for you. But I gotta be honest with you. I get excited about this side just as much. Because when you get this, the Bible says the power of the Holy Spirit, now you're not walking around with natural strength, but now you got supernatural strength. You know what it's like to walk through your hallways, sit in your lunchroom, the power of God on your life? It's when you got the gift to prophesy, heal the sick, the gift of faith, words of wisdom and words of knowledge, tongues, interpretation of tongues, discernment. Jesus was not just excited that you got an agent to help you feel good and do good, but he was excited because he knew to get this message out of his love, to build the church, which is the hope of the world, that you and I, we would need some power that is beyond any human limitation. That what separates us from the world is that this power that raised him is this power that uses us. That we're a cut above. That we've got some lethal injection. That I'm walking down the street and I see somebody and I'm like, I don't need, stop messing with me, man. I don't even know them. Okay, fine. And you go up to a stranger like, sir, I'm so sorry. I felt like I heard God say this, that you're in this situation, and I just want to encourage you. God told me to tell you everything's going to be all right. You're on heaven's radar, sir. I don't know. The Holy Spirit told me to tell you. Someone's in your home, and they've got something like leukemia or cancer or a fever. And you're going, I don't know why. I'm not perfect. I don't even know that much scripture, but I feel the Holy Spirit saying, I'm supposed to lay hands on you right now, and there's a power that's in my life, and I believe that through the blood of Jesus and the Holy Spirit, I can lay hands on the sick, and they're going to come to recovery. Some of you got the gift to prophesy, which, by the way, we don't want one gift from the Holy Spirit. We want all gifts. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 1, eagerly desire the gifts of God. I'm a healing guy. I heal. No, I want all of them. I want to help people any way I can because I've been helped and I got a helper and I got an agent, but I'm trying to go tell the world there's a God who loves you and is for you and wants to help you, and he died on the cross and the purpose for the power is for people. Would you stand to your feet tonight? You might be here going like, man, preacher, that's cool. That's cool. That's cool, man. You mind opening that for me, sweetie? Can you open that for me? make some noise for this Holy Spirit filled. I got an agent. Going like, you don't know my story. You don't realize like I'm nothing from nobody. I got issues. I'm not perfect. How could God give me power to be used? Like that stuff doesn't make sense. Like I'm just gonna be satisfied. Like God loves me. That's cool. It's good. I believe that God's called some people out tonight. Saying like, no. If you'd actually just give me your life, I'll use it beyond anything you ever asked, dreamed, or imagined. I'm just looking for somebody to use. Come on, young people. God is not looking for capability. He's looking for availability. And some people that would just say, I know I'm a mess. And I know I'm not perfect. But I got an agent. Say, well, who gets the power? Do you got to go to a class? Do you got to know like 10 verses? Who gets this stuff? You want to know what's amazing to me? I love it. I'm going to end with this. The 8th room, the Holiday Inn, 8th floor, 2 acoustic guitars, oceans, top of their lungs. You know who's up in that room? You know who receives the power? You know who gets an agent that night? How about a guy named Peter? Very scary, almost fell. Thank God I have an agent that felt like angels in the outfield just picked me up. I got an agent. Proof that I have an agent. Peter's up there, man. Wait. Peter. The same guy that just a few weeks ago when Jesus was in his darkest moment, when Jesus needed him the most, when he was getting betrayed, when he was getting whipped, when there was a crown of thorns upon his brow, his boy, his best friend, is standing over there. Peter, Peter's in failure. Peter's denying that he even knows God. He's going like, I don't even know Jesus. I don't even have a relationship with Jesus. And yet Jesus, when he dies on the cross, he was thinking of Peter. When he gets up out the grave, the first one he goes looking for is a man named Peter, and he restores him. And he helps him. And he puts him up in the upper room. He places him in the upper room. As if to say, if Peter gets the agent, you can have the agent. If I can use this guy, I can use you. And when the power came, and Peter got filled with the Spirit of God, the Bible records that the first sermon that was ever preached in the history of the church was by a failure named Peter, who preached the gospel, and 3,000 people got saved. Because God does not use perfect people. God, he uses open people. He uses people that would just say, fill me and use me. I want the power. Come on, lift your hands tonight if you want the power of God. Jesus, tonight, we open up our hearts and we open up our lives. Come on, let's worship tonight. Come on, let's praise him tonight. Come on, let's praise him. Let's worship. Come on. Come on, open the floodgates. Let it rain.
Holy Spirit. We yield our life to you. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh. Come help us right now, Holy Spirit. Help us. Comfort us. Teach us. Guide us. Holy Spirit, remind us right now. Speak our language. Give us vision. Give us dreams. We're open. We're open. Anything you want. I'll go anywhere. I'll do anything. My life is not my life. It belongs to you. Holy Spirit, I yield right now. I do not walk by the flesh, but now I walk according to the Spirit. I'm a Spirit-filled, Spirit-led, whatever you want. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I want to give a response right now. And I'm just going to ask anybody tonight that you would say, if you really mean this, that God would give someone like me power to serve others, then I want to ask the Lord, God, would you fill me with that power? Because I want to go help a broken, lost, hurting world that needs you. Here's, sign me up. I want the power. Please hear me before you put all the hands down, just real fast. We do not want the power for us. This is not so you can be famous. This is not so you can have a following. This is not so you can get a microphone. This is for people that have a heart for a world that is lost and needs Jesus. The power of God. Please hear me. I'm going to ask you. This bothers me. We're not even asking for the power of God to make much of the power of God. We're not glorifying or edifying the power of God. You know that the Father is obsessed with the Son and the Holy Spirit only points to Jesus. The power of God is only proof of Jesus. Y'all can keep playing. Don't leave me there. I'm giving you context because I don't want people going out going like, ooh, ooh, ooh. You don't want to mess with me, man. I heal people. No, you don't. God heals people. No, you don't. Come on, I'm looking for some people that want to make much of Jesus. They want Jesus to be famous. They want to preach Jesus and point people to Jesus. Come on, if you want the power of God in your life, lift your hands as high as they will go. Father, I pray right now, Holy Spirit, invade our world. Fill us right now with every gift from heaven, with the gift of prophesy, words of healing, words of wisdom, words of knowledge, miracles, discernment.
drums. Come on, let's ask him. Let it rain. I'm so thankful that you're my agent. I'm so thankful that I have you, but God, I want others to know you. Anybody have a burden for other people to know Jesus? And Holy Spirit, use my life. Use me. I'm telling you, some of you you're gonna interact with people different after this night. You're gonna go, I always used to sense something that I was supposed to, but I was not. Nah, man, that's me. That's God speaking your language. Telling you, no, go. No, dude. I need you. I need you to be my, Jesus saying, don't you move. Don't you leave. Don't you leave Jerusalem. Don't you leave that hotel room until you get it, because once you get it, you're going to wreck the world. The world will never be the same. You're going to Jerusalem and Judea and Dallas and San Antonio and Houston and El Paso, and you're gonna go through every area, Austin, and they'll never be safe. I'm gonna ask in just a moment. I'm gonna give a very specific altar call tonight, and I want to pray tonight. I want to ask if you are a 12-year-old tonight, if you're 12 years old, if you make your way to the altar. Anybody that's 12, come on up here to the front. Any 12-year-olds? Can we put our hands together for all the 12-year-olds? All the 12-year-olds. All the 12-year-olds, come on down here. Come on, keep clapping for them. Look at these guys. Wow. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Extend your hands this way towards the 12-year-olds. If you're 12, if you're a 12-year-old, you just lift your hands high. I want to pray a glorious obsession over you. Jesus, we declare right now over every 12-year-old. Thank you that they will be about the Father's business. Thank you that they're in the house growing with wisdom and favor and stature. Thank you that right now, God, you're giving them a dream about their life. Listen, I was 12 years old. I was in a church meeting.
God gave me a vision for my life. God gave me a purpose for my life. He gave me a direction for my life. I was 12 and I started to read the Bible. I was 12 and I started to lead in my church. I was 12 and I started to lead worship. I was 12 years old. When I fell in love with Jesus, I was 12. Come on, 12-year-olds. Come on, church. Come on, church. We're believing for them right now. We're declaring it. Spirit of God. Spirit of God. Over the 12-year-olds. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 12-year-olds, I want you to stay up here. If you're a senior, you're going into your senior year of high school, I want you to come stand down here. Seniors, all the seniors, come make your way and stand with them right here. Come on. All the seniors, come down here. You're going to be a senior in high school. Come here, seniors. Come on, make a way, make a way, make a way. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just keep coming, keep coming. All the way to the front. Come on. All the way, all the way. Squeeze in, squeeze in. Squeeze in, squeeze in. All the way to the wall. All the way. All the way. Thank you, Jesus. Look at all these guys. Come on, give it up for our seniors one more time. Graduate. Come on. Come on. Amazing. 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 I just figured, if we can get the sixth graders and we can get the seniors within the middle school and the junior high will praise the Lord, and then the high school, they're going to praise the Lord, and we're going to see a whole generation that worships God. I just figure if we're starting from the bottom and now we're here, we might as well praise all the way through. Oh, come on, if you got some faith tonight, come on, lift your voice. Lift your hands. Come on, let's praise the Lord. Come on, let it rain. Come on. Around the seniors, 12-year-olds, just put your hand on a senior's shoulder. God, we pray over the leaders of our schools, the oldest kids in the classes. Give them divine appointments. Make a way in their classrooms, on the football field, in the gym. We're thanking you that right now, God, something's going to happen in our schools. There's an awakening that's coming. There's a revival that's coming. Thank you that you're using our young people. You're using the students. Just as you said, you're going to turn the hearts of the children to the fathers and the hearts of the fathers to the children. We release right now the seniors in the schools. We thank you that right now our seniors are praying together. They're fasting together. They're in Bible study together. They're saying, my school's going to know the Lord. My school's going to worship God. My school's coming to church. My principal's getting saved. My teachers are getting saved. My coach is getting saved. Use our seniors, God.
Use our seniors, Lord. In the name of Jesus. 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 You know, my senior year of high school, my best friend and I, we made a decision together, PC. My senior year of high school, my best friend and I said, we're going to pray every day at our lunch. We're going to eat for half of the lunch, and the second half of the lunch, we're going to pray for our school. First day of school, we ate half of the meal, 15 minutes in. We go to my mom's classroom, 2,500 kids in my high school. We go to my mom. My mom taught in the public schools. We go to my mom's room. The three of us would pray for our school that day. Pray for our principal. Pray for our friends that weren't saved. By name, we just begin to pray. Three of us. We're praying. God, you're going to move this year. This is the year of the Lord. Three of us. End of the week, five of us pray. Every day. About a month into school, it's 10 of us. 2 months, 15 of us. Pretty soon, come October, November, it's about 30 of us praying every day. Praying every day. 40 of us. 50 of us. We used to sit in the class in the lunchroom. 15 minutes in, I stand up. Look at my friends. Let's go. We had to go to the choir room because we couldn't fit anymore. 50, 60, 70, 80. We can't fit in the choir room no more. We got to go to the gym. You know what it's like to be in your school, eat for 15 minutes, stand up, and say, come on. We're going to pray, and 115 kids get up and go to the gym and begin to pay God and ask God. Oh, come on. If you believe that the power of God is on this generation, lift your voice, lift your hands. Come on, let it rain.